Well, oh man, now you need to imagine somebody smacking my face and it's going slow motion and spit comes out of. Well, welcome to Programming with Cute Widgets. In the previous episode, we went super slow. That was what my small animation there was showing you. We went super slow on common widgets in Qt. We only covered label, line edit, and Qt text edit. And I promise you, in this episode, it'll be slow again, but we'll go into a lot of details. Jesper, besides being slow, what is this episode about? Well, it's about the common widgets in Qt. We are looking at their APIs and what is available. And sometimes there is a bit of surprise. We saw that with the QLabel in the previous episode that also were the ones showing the images. Remember, we'll understand why the API is so weird for a Qt progress bar. And we'll delve into some details with Qt Spinbox that you might not even realize that you can do. So stay tuned. I will show you a lot of stuff. We'll start out with something as simple as a Qt checkbox. Well, actually, four even: Qt checkbox, Qt radio button, Qt push button, and Qt tool button, because they all are inheriting from Qt abstract button. And why do they inherit from it? What does a checkbox and a push button have in common? Well, maybe somebody was drinking a bit too much of the object-oriented fountain when they implemented this, but they do. And it's worthwhile to notice because if I go and look at the documentation for Qt radio button or Qt tool button, as I have up here, I might find that the properties are rather simple, but that's because that the API is actually in the Qt abstract button. So if I was looking for how to set the icon on a Qt tool button, I would need to go to the Qt abstract button and find the API. So what do we have? Qt push button. As you can see over here in these ancient screenshots from Mac, I believe in 2000, a tool button is something that you can, or a push button is something you can press and then release again. And it actually has the facility of being pressed down and stay down. That is the Qt push button. I'm sure we have it somewhere. Otherwise, oh yeah, it is. Set checked, set checkable. So that's how you can get a toggleable, toggleable push button. I mentioned push button and tool button, and tool buttons is what goes onto your toolbar. While push button is the OK and cancel button, but you can actually use tool buttons in your API too if you want to, or in your user interfaces if you want to. They are just like a Qt push button with one minor exception, namely that the constructor, super annoying. Let me just go over and show you, right? The constructor of our Qt abstract button, our Qt tool button constructor, come on down here, just take a Qt widget parent. It does not take a Qt string text as our Qt push button constructor does, which is slightly annoying. But the fancy thing about tool button is that its size hint, meaning the size that it asks to get in a layout, is slightly smaller. So a tool button is somewhat smaller. So if you have a row of stuff that is supposed to feel more condensed in the UI, then a tool button might be the right thing. A push button do take the text here as a parameter. It you can call set icon. So that's how we got an icon over here. You can connect obviously from the tool button so that there's a click signal. Doesn't bring anything out, of course. What would it bring out? But that's the most common one to listen to. Radio buttons are these things that we have over here. If I click here, then this one would be unselected. So one is selected at a time. And as we talked about in the Qt Designer episodes, if the radio buttons do have a common parent, then you do not need to specify anything for them to get into this. But if they do not have the common parent, or if there is two groups of radio buttons that all of them have this common parent, then what you need is a Qt button group to get the radio button behavior. And let me just give you a link here to an episode from Qt Widgets and More, where I looked at how do you set this up in Qt Designer, because these button groups, very hidden feature, at least until you know about it inside of Qt Designer. But we're looking at the code here. The checkbox, just give it a text and a parent, or do not give it a parent, as we talked about in the previous episode. Radio button, same thing here. And the checkbox also has the possibility of being a try state. So checked, unchecked, or maybe. Well, that's if you have multiple things on your user interface selected, and some of them are to be checked and some of them unchecked, and you want to indicate that these three things that you have in your user interface selected currently, or whatever that means to you, that some of them is in the checked and some of them is in the unchecked, and that you can do with a try stage. The only thing left to say is that this Qt button group actually has the facility of emitting a signal when one of the abstract buttons, so it could be both push button and radio buttons and checkbox, whatever that goes into a button group, when one of them is emitting its clicked signal, then this button group will tell that this particular one was clicked. Useful in rare situations, but now you know about it. I did warn you that this episode would be slower than watching paint dry, right? Well, let's go and look at three other widgets now that does not seem to be having much in common, namely a QSlider and a QSpinbox. Okay, they are like ranged input, and then there's QProgressBar. How does that fit in there? I'll tell you. Let's start looking at the API of a QSlider. Well, the user interface looks like what you have over there. You've seen those quite a few times in your life. The API for QSlider is, it takes the orientation first. Is it horizontal? And I always, whenever I need to do these things, I need to go like horizontal, vertical. That not because I'm Christian and trying to baptize you. It's horizontal. That is what the horizont, that's how I remember it. So it can be horizontal or it can be vertical. And that's the first parameter. And then the second is the parent. That is optional. Actually, the horizontal here is also optional, and it will create, I had to look it up, it'll create a slider that's vertical. So why would it even be possible to make a slider without specifying the orientation? Of course, in your code, you shouldn't, but why is that possible even? Pause now. You did not pause me, did you? Pause now and think about it. I'll tell you. The reason why it's possible is that you cannot create widgets from Qt Designer with any parameters to the constructors. Therefore, there needs to be a QSlider constructor, not taking anything. Inside of Qt Designer, you drag in a horizontal or vertical slider, and obviously the next thing that the code generator from Qt Designer does is that it'll say the slider generator here, set orientation, Qt horizontal or Qt vertical. But of course, in your code, if you write this by hand, by all means, do write it horizontal or vertical. Then you can set the range. That's from 0 to 99 here. Sometimes it's from, what's it, std whatever, min, and to std max int or whatever. You can set the value here. That's the current value of the slider. And finally, connects to its value change signal. There's actually a few different signals. Go and look at them up yourself. But there is a few different signals coming out of QSlider. But before we go there, I have something to talk to you about. I'd like to talk to you about API design. And trust me, if you take a physical training with me, there would be lots of side discussions like these, way more than what's in this more narrow training here. So this is not a replacement for physical training. Was that just an advertise? Sorry. API design. Have you ever created a function? And just for the simplicity, let's just call it f. The function f does something, and then you come back to it a year later and you say, oh yes, there is this corner case where if the moon is fully lit up, then it should do something different. And how I tell it that the moon is fully lit up is that I'll give it a parameter into the function. So I'll call f with give it a boolean. So you adapt the API f to say bool moon is fully lit up, and now you can call it with either true or false. No, never done that? Okay, so you never written a single line of code, I guess. Well, you should stop doing that. And there's a link right now to an episode from Qt Widgets and More where I talked about API designs in depth and lots and lots of good examples in there. And the reason why I talk about that now is that in the Qt slider, you saw that the API said set range and set value. It hasn't been like this all the time. Back in the good old days of Qt version 2, there was a slightly different API. Back then, the Qt slider took the value, it took the range, it took even the page step. So you'd end up with a new Qt slider, 0, 10, 100, 42, Qt colon colon horizontal, and this. These were all parameters to the Qt slider I just listed up there. I am not kidding you. That was possible. You can find the Qt2 documentation of Qt slider out there. In Qt3, they cleaned that up. And a lot of us had a lot of fun pointing out that they had pointed out that in that Qt was this API where you'd write less. And now you need to write much more. But the key thing for that, and the same thing for your Boolean parameter there, they said you write the code once and then you read it and maintain it a lot of times. So set range 0,99 is so much easier to understand than it is to go to the QSlider instance that you create with new QSlider and figure out that it's the second and the fourth parameter that's a range, the third parameter is the current value, or however it is, because it just say 0, 10, 100, or even worse, 0, 10, 10. Which of them is the maximum and which is the current value? That's difficult when you need to go and change the API or change the invocation of that particular slider. Set range 0, 10 and set value 10. There it's easy to change the range to 100. You know exactly where it is. They wrote a pretty good article about this stuff, and there's a link here again for this or in the description note about changes to or how you design your API. It's, I guess, 15, 20 years old now, but still very valuable. So go and watch these once you're done watching this episode here. Let's go and look at Qt Progress Bar now. My favorite story of interaction with GitHub is a customer that once asked us, can you help us with a problem we have with our USB driver? And who in their right mind would ask what is perceived to be a UI company to do that stuff? Well, a customer that knows that we can deliver high quality wherever you ask for it. You see a Qt progress bar right over here? It's the thing that can tell you that we are 42% here, it seems, through reformatting your hard disk or doing the calculation in your spreadsheet or whatever we're doing here. And a progress bar is created like this, new Qt progress bar. You set the range and set the value. And this is where, why set the range? Why not just set steps? Actually, it wasn't Qt 2 days. And then they decided, let's try and make the API as discoverable as possible. So range it, input stuff. Let's go with set range. So that's how you specified here. Set the value to be 42. That's the current value. And whenever you do your formatting of the hard disk, that's when you call this the set value. You actually need to spin the event loop once, which you do by calling qapp pointer progress event for the value to actually be displayed on the screen. The format, you can specify that. That is a rather optional, but you can see up here it says 42 and 42%, and sometimes it shows up inside the scroll bar. It's or inside the progress bar itself. That depends on the style of your Qt. So the style sheet or the style, the Qt style that you've set up there. But again, the key thing here really is the set range and set value. And let's just look at the other one, Qt spinbox down here. Qt spinbox It has a range and it has a value, and you can set a prefix and a postfix. And just as we speak, actually, I created a note to myself to add an episode to Qt Widgets and More. You know about that series, right? And at the time you watch this, maybe it has already come out, an episode on how the Qt Spin Box actually also has a facility. Oh, come on, I'll show you. Let's go over and look at the Qt Spin Box here. So, question mark, Qt Spin Box. The Qt Spin Box has a facility, if you look down here, to get to actually, I got tricked by that before, because I need to go and look at the Qt Abstract Spin Box, or I can just go down here. Oh, come on, where is it? Not anymore. It used to have show me all. Never mind. I'll go and look at it at Qt Abstract Spin Box. The Qt Abstract Spin Box has the facility of getting to the underlying line edit, because the Spin Box actually just has a Qt line edit in there. So I can get to the line edit. And when I go into the line edit, what I can do is, if I just have action here, and there we are, add action with a Qt icon. What I can get, let me just show you the screenshot again over here. Here I have a spin box and I can get to the line edit there. And with this, I can add action at a line edit position, and the line edit position is either leading or trailing. What I basically can get is an icon in here or over there, depending on it. Why would I want that? Well, I actually, and you have to watch Qt Widgets and More for the full detail. I created a very simple editor for currencies. So I could specify $200 or 500 euros. And over in this right side here on my spin box, I had a small icon where I could click, and that would bring up an editor for choosing the currency. Pretty nifty. So how's your painting coming along? You are repainting your apartment or your house or whatever while watching these super slow episodes, right? See if your paint dries faster than me getting through all the widgets in Qt. And I'm not even going to go through all of them, but there's going to be at least one more episode. And in this episode, I'll talk about Qt Group Box and Qt Tab Widget. And I'll talk about Qt Stack Widget and Qt Combo Box and a few other widgets. So until tomorrow, when the next episode comes out, have a great time.